Our scripture reading today comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 9, verses 35 through 38. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, be with us this day. Create in each of us a pure heart and put a right spirit in us so we may do your work now and always. Amen. There was a man out in the country driving in a desolate area, and he got into a spot of trouble when his car drove into a ditch. Luckily, a farmer came by and offered to help. He had with him his big, strong plow horse named Buddy. He said to the man, "Buddy can pull your car out of the ditch for you." So he hitched Buddy up to the car and he yelled, "Pull, Nellie, pull!" And Buddy didn't move. And then he made a couple of adjustments and then he yelled, "Pull, Buster, pull!" Buddy didn't move. And he tried one more time and the farmer hollered, "Pull, Coco, pull!" Buddy didn't move. Finally, the farmer yelled, "Pull, Buddy, pull!" And the horse pulled and the car easily came out of the ditch. The driver of the car was most appreciative and very confused. He asked the man why he had called his horse by the wrong name three times. The farmer said, "Oh, Buddy is lying. If he thought he was the only one pulling, he wouldn't even try." I begin with this story because the farmer, in his own special way, had a great deal of compassion for his horse Buddy. And compassion is our focus for today. More specifically, the kind of compassion that Jesus displayed in his ministry. Verse 36 of this morning's scripture states, "When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd." William Barclay gives a lot of time and attention to the word compassion. He says that the Greek word used in this verse was the strongest word that the Greeks had for pity. A pity so intense that it moved a person to the very depth of their being. The word is not often used in Scripture, but when it does appear, it is used to convey a compassion that breaks the heart. Let me give you a couple of examples where this word is used in relation to Jesus. He was moved with compassion for the sick, for those possessed by demons, and for the blind. He was moved to compassion when the widow of Nain was to bury her son. He was moved to compassion by those that were hungry. The sight of the tired and hungry clothes laid upon his heart. And in today's scripture, he was moved to compassion because the people were longing for God. And the Pharisees and the scribes and the religious leaders of the day were doing nothing for those who were suffering. Jesus had pity on the people and his heart went out to them. I think that Jesus' compassion allowed him to see the world differently than the religious leaders of his time. The leaders in Jesus' time saw people who were sinful, and therefore they got what they deserved. Jesus saw people who needed to be saved. The leaders saw people who needed to be admonished for not obeying the law. Jesus saw people who needed to be given strength to live. The leaders used their knowledge of the law to restrain the people and keep them down. Jesus met everyone face to face and helped them stand The leaders saw religion and the law as a handicap to keep people from growing. Jesus came to encourage, to build, to support, and to never tear apart. And it is that kind of compassion that we need to display in our lives. Jesus' compassion hit the very depth of his heart. It was a compassion that had no strings attached. It was genuine. It allowed people to grow in their faith and ever move forward. Jesus' compassion attacked an issue or a need, and it never attacked the person. It was a compassion without criticism, without judgment, and without any obligations attached to it. We need to display that compassion that touches our heart and moves us to act. Now, at the beginning of this passage, we learn that Jesus was reaching out. He was teaching, he was preaching, he was healing. Jesus was known for these attributes, not just because he used them to bring forth God's message, but because he used them and did these things with the utmost of compassion. So let's look at them. First, Jesus was a teacher. We all know that he was famous for his teaching methods, using familiar objects to make his point, relaying his message to everyday life events, having one-on-one conversations with people that could be turned into teachable moments. He did all of these things well, and he is probably best known for his ability to tell a parable, to relate it to every single person in a different and unique manner. But Jesus was not just a teacher, he was a compassionate one, which meant his teaching always had to be full of grace and mercy and forgiveness. And also Jesus was a preacher. He preached in the boats on the lakeshore. He gave his famous Sermon on the Mount and Sermon on the Plain. He came proclaiming a message. He brought forth to the people the message of God and God's love for us. So what is it in your mind that makes a good preacher? What qualities should that person possess? Should they be kind, knowledgeable, pastoral? Should they be honest, relatable, approachable, compassionate? Now, I know when you hear that list, you automatically turn your thoughts to me. As you should. But I do believe that Jesus as a preacher possessed in spades all of these qualities. And those abilities made him the best person to proclaim the word of God. And his compassion as a preacher was brought forth by his confidence as a preacher. When Jesus preached, it was with certainty. No wavering in his convictions, no vacillating in his faith, no uncertainty in his voice. A church, its pastor, its members have to be firm in their convictions. And one of the most compassionate acts Jesus performed was how he, with confidence, could proclaim the word of God. One of the key components of our faith is that we need to be fully committed to it. And when we can do that, we can demonstrate that same confidence that gives us compassion to act and move forward. And finally, Jesus was a healer. The Gospels are replete with examples of Jesus engaged in all sorts of healing. Blindness, deafness, demon possessions, withered hand, blood disorders, leprosy, raising people from the dead. And Jesus didn't just heal the physical needs, he also healed people by forgiving their sins so that they were whole on the inside as well as on the outside. And Jesus, when he healed, discovered that healing was important. Healing is important because when he healed someone, it made people feel better. It allowed them to live fuller, richer lives. It made them thankful. It showed them God's love. Also, when Jesus healed someone, it allowed him to do something. In other words, Jesus' ministry was not solely based on his teaching and preaching. It also had to do with him being moved to action. The religious people in Jesus' time would have said that religion and faith is based on following the law, on showing good deeds, on making public sacrifices. Jesus based his religion and faith on love. And that's really the point of today's sermon. We are focusing on the compassion of Jesus, and that compassion is rooted in the love of God. Jesus taught in parables. He preached in the synagogues. He healed wherever he went. All acts of love. Those that don't love spend their time breaking things down and tearing them apart. Love seeks to build someone up. And Jesus always did that. He took the opportunity to build someone up, to show God's love, and to be moved to compassion. And we must strive in our lives of following Christ to do the same. We must do the same. God's love for us, Jesus' compassion for us, should make us leap out of bed every day, ready to serve and live for God. Now the story I'm about to tell you, although I'm not going to get very far in it, this story I'm about to tell you is a true story. Well, it's basically true. You know how stories over the years get turned and twisted and turned into myth and folklore. But from the version I'm going to tell you, it's a true story. And the version I'm going to tell you is one that Max Lucado tells in his book, The Eye of the Storm. It's a Friday evening, and the sun is starting to set, and the scene is a beach. The beach is basically deserted. People are preparing to start celebrating the weekend this Friday night. The waves are ebbing and flowing ever so slightly. There's a couple walking along the wet sand. There is a bright orange ball in the sky, beautiful sight as the sun begins to set. There's an old man, a little haggard, a little hobbly, and he's walking along the beach towards the pier. And he's got in his hand one of those old pail buckets that you see fishermen use when they're at the beach. And when he gets to the pier, there's a seagull or two on the pier, and he reaches into his bucket, and he throws them some shrimp. And as he does this, another seagull appears, and another, and soon the sky is filled with dozens and dozens and dozens of seagulls, all coming to be fed from the shrimp in this man's bucket. Soon all the shrimp is gone. The seagulls don't leave. They land on his head. They land on his shoulders. They sit at his feet, almost as if they are having a chat with him and enjoying the conversation. Who is this person? What is so special about the fact that every Friday night he shows up with a bucket of shrimp and feeds all the fish? Well, the legend or the true story goes that the man's name was Eddie Rickenbacker, and most of you will recognize that name. He was a World War II hero and pilot. And one day, one of his missions, his plane goes down, and him and seven crew members all survive but are stranded on rafts in the ocean, and I think it was for 24 days. And all eight of them survive under the leadership and direction of their captain, Eddie Rickenbacker. Eddie was a Christian man. He made sure every day they did devotions and they kept themselves centered on what they had to do. And what they had to do was survive until they were rescued. And they had to do that amidst the dangers of what it must have been like to be on a raft for 24 days in the middle of nowhere with sharks circling and being stranded in the middle of a war. That could be dangerous depending on which side gets to you first. But their biggest threat, their immediate problem, was not starving to death. And here's where all the seagulls come in. Because one day on the raft while Eddie was lying down with his hat over his face, a seagull lands on his head. As soon as he felt it, he knew what it was. All other seven people witnessing it knew what it was. And they knew that they had to have that seagull. And they did, they caught it. And they decided that the seagull was there to help them. It was a sacrifice to them. So they used that seagull to survive. They ate that seagull. And they took the insides out, and they made bait out of it. And they fished for it, and they were able to catch fish. And they were able to survive from starvation. And because of that seagull being there, all eight of them were rescued and did survive and did not die of starvation. So for years and years after that day, once the war was over and Eddie went back to his life and so on and so forth, as the legend goes, every Friday night, he took a bucket of shrimp, went to the pier, and with a grateful heart, every Friday as he was feeding those seagulls, he said, thank you, thank you. Our God's love for us, Christ's compassion for us, should make us jump out of bed every morning and say, thank you, thank you, thank you. Now, when you all go home today, and you all go to lunch, and you're talking about how fabulous this sermon was, I don't know why you're all laughing. How fabulous this sermon was, and how much you got out of worship today, prayers, the music, the singing, take a moment and talk about what you gave today in worship. For the next week, try something. Get up every morning and say to God, God, what can I do for you today? And do one thing for God each day over the next 7 days and see if it makes a difference. I know it will because God loves us so much that God is moved to compassion every day, and we can say thank you by doing the same, by the way we